Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the late start, episode 2 of the new year 2020. Good morning, Chris.
Episode 2? Oh my gosh. Does that mean we have to do recaps? Previously on Idiotic. What if I haven't seen episode 1? Will I still be able to follow episode 2? Anyway, good morning, everybody. Welcome.
Hey, I hope everybody has their coffee with them and they're all warmed up. We have the wonderful and amazing Kevin Thorn with us today. Everybody give a big round of applause to Kevin Thorn. Woohoo!
I can hear the crowd cheering, clapping. Oh, there we go. There's clapping in the chat.
There we go.
The golf clap.
All righty. Very cool. So we got another cool thing. Maybe folks joined us in the fall. We did a Drink'n'Draw with Kevin, where he walked us through, and I'm gonna mangle up the name, but among other things, the knowledge nuggets that you dropped us on us was that the visual alphabet, right? That's what you know, how to make a picture of anything using a handful of sort of separate individual design pieces, and that was a hoot. I went back and I was telling my wife about that. So it's like, oh no, trust me, you could do it with a line and a circle, and she's kind of looking at it and going, oh, yes.
Yeah, sure you can.
Sure you can.
That's it's okay, nice Chris. Sure nice you year. Can. Can I get you a soft pillow?
Yes. Lou is asking, okay, perfect. Other folks have confirmed that their sound is okay. That's always a thing we jump on. Oh, jeepers, technical. And Roxanne, it seems, I'm hoping other folks can chime in that their video is okay. It doesn't sound like anybody else is having issues. Awesome. We have the best tech support right in the chat.
Right. And all of the producers hanging out with us, doing all of the good background work.
That's right.
Tech support nowadays is, hey, it's good on my end.
That's right. Did you turn it off and turn it back on again?
Anyway. Yeah, so we're pushing all the tools really hard today because we're going to be doing some fancy screen sharing stuff, right, Kevin? Talking about illustrating again. We'll skip the visual alphabet stuff, although it could come in handy for today's particular topic, I might add.
Might be something we have to end up working on. Yeah. But let's, Kevin, let's get you to do the quick intro of yourself just for case folks sure. haven't ever joined us with you along for the ride before.
The quick intro is born and raised in Chicago, ran away and joined the Army, retired after a career, then went to corporate America, started and pursued an IT degree or an IT degree and an IT career. And then right around the Y2K thing, there was some training and some stuff going on. So I was invited to the training department to offer some technical training, and then that led to the training department, which then led to all things learning and development in corporate America. Fast forward another decade, I met Brent. Brent invited me to present, and it's his fault I'm here today.
I'll take full blame for it.
And then fast forward another few years, I quit the corporate job and started Nuggethead Studios. Independent consultant, designer, animator, illustrator, e-learning developer, teacher, trainer, professor, I don't know, whatever you want to call it. Just throw anything on there.
Excellent.
And I've been drawing my whole life. So I never went to school to draw. I went to school for everything else, but never went to school to draw.
And that's kind of an important thing, I think, to throw out there because, I mean, most of us, you know, many of us anyway are kind of daunted by the idea of, oh, I have no talent. I have no, so, but you're living proof that you don't have to go and get an art degree in order to throw this kind of creativity into the mix. That's very cool.
Well, arguably, Chris, everything I learned in L&D, I didn't go to school for either.
yeah, fair enough.
It wasn't until 2 years ago. I mean, I'm 55, so I got my master's degree in instructional design when I was 53. So I kind of self-taught myself everything about the industry, and same thing with IT. I started the idea of getting into IT was It was, believe it or not, it was Macromedia Flash version 4. Caught my attention. And I thought, wow, because let me back up a little bit farther. I submitted my portfolio to Disney. That was my dream, to be a Disney artist animator. And I got rejected with flying colors from Disney, and it just like depressed me. So that's when I ran away and joined the Army. And, but then, you know, fast forward, and I saw Flash 4, and I thought, wow, I can animate my own cartoons. So I started self-teaching myself the technology and HTML and all that, and animation, and in order to I just wanted to see my own things move, animate. And then I went to school after I learned how to do everything. And the same thing with L&D. But the drawing part of it, it was just a natural gift.
Mm-hmm. So we have a official topic today, which we thought we'd go down the channel of thinking about creating icons for learning projects. Yeah. Which is really kind of it's kind of a simple thing, right? We think of icons as small and little and tiny, relatively speaking. Certainly not, you know, large canvases, etc. But there's some knacks and some tricks and some important things to think about with them. And we've all Go ahead, Kevin.
Jump in. It goes back to what you were saying a minute ago about the visual library. Communicating visually, it's a lot of times it's about a metaphor. It's not necessarily the details. And one of my good friends, who is a syndicated cartoonist, taught me a long time ago, if you can communicate an image with as few lines as possible, then you don't need all the other detail, because the brain magically fills in the gaps. The brain will take care of the rest. So, I mean, we can go on and on, but so an icon or iconography, if we think of things that we automatically assume that send a message, and my favorite example is the little floppy disk and saving a document. It's 2020 and we haven't used floppy disks in 20 years, but yet everybody recognizes that icon as save. So the metaphor behind saving files or saving something to something else, you don't need all of the details around that. You just need some kind of a visual icon in order to communicate what it is you're wanting them to do or see or communicate. So, and icons, and a lot of times there's icon packs and stuff like that. How many of you, like in the chat right now, how many of you are on a project and you need icons for your project and you go find icon packs, but there's that one icon missing from that pack? Like you get this 50 icon library and you're like, it's got everything I need except, wait, where's that? Oh my gosh.
Well, they have the one that you want, but it just doesn't look right. It's not the right, like,
yeah,
style.
It doesn't. Right.
Yeah. I want the little notch in the corner to be taken out of the bottom left corner, and I want it to be blue instead of white, and it's a, I want it to be more rectangular.
Right. And then, or then you go and you pull six icons out of a pack, and you're looking for that one more. And then you go find it, but now it's a different style. And you're like, well, how do I get this icon to look like these other icons in the same style? And that's where the struggle is. So what hopefully in the little bit of time that we have, I can show you some quick tips where you can create your own with a couple little tools and you can go on your way. So Becky is awesome.
Yeah. That lines up nicely with Mark, who's got a question already.
Okay.
Our team typically uses Illustrator to create icons. I'm not as proficient in it as I'd like yet, but it seems one of the ideal programs to create them. Are there tools that you like to use or recommend to create icons? So, Mark, you're in the wheelhouse today.
Yeah, well, Mark, you're in the right spot, because I'm going to demo a quick example in Illustrator. And you only need three tools in Illustrator to do what we need to do. So if... There you go. You don't need, that's the one thing about Adobe products, Photoshop, Illustrator, and the rest of them, they're quite intimidating. And I'll be the first one to say that I probably use about 20% of the tools in all the Adobe products, because I only use them for what I need them for. I don't use everything. So don't be intimidated by the tool. There's probably just 10 or 20% of what you need out of it. But that is a lot more powerful than a lot of the other tools. So if you just take the time to get used to it, and if you don't, PowerPoint can do the same thing. And we can do another session on creating icons in PowerPoint maybe at another time. Okay, what are we going to do? We're going to try something here.
Yeah, let's fire up that screen share and just show people.
If we want to just, we're going to shout out and ask people for an idea for an icon.
Sure, give me an idea.
So
who needs an icon that they can't find? A boat. Okay. Sunshine, cloud. Oh, we got a lot. Zombie an icon, Cassie?
A light bulb.
Well, of course, Joe would say a light bulb. Toast on. time travel. That's a good one. Ooh. Data connectivity. Now we're talking about themes and stuff like that. Those get really, e-learning is probably the most, what is e-learning? What is an icon for e-learning?
Yeah, I mean, we have a hard enough time just defining it. I don't know.
Let's go.
First come, first serve. Jennifer was first, so let's do a boat.
Okay. Initiating an icon for initiating the boat feature in our upcoming e-learning.
There we go.
Okay, let's do a boat. All right, let's see. We got to do which. I need to change my camera. That's the first thing I need to do. Okay.
And I'm gonna minimize.
There we go.
I'm going to toggle my video down just so we get a little bit of horsepower benefit, hopefully, out of that.
Now, this is upside down because the camera's over there. So, and I'm left-handed. So this is the only way you can see me draw and where my camera is. So bear with me. And while I'm doing this, I do want to point out that creativity and design, all of us are creative. We work in a creative industry. Shut your laptop. Step away from all the technology. And just grab a pen. This is just a little, a dollar flare felt tip pen. You don't need anything. And this is a piece of paper out of the printer. So this is where design starts, is on this paper. So let's see. Let me get down, find a good center spot here. So we're going to draw a boat. We got a couple ideas. So when we draw a boat, oh, great. So this pen doesn't want to draw. There we go. So when we're going to draw a boat, we got the bottom. We can do that. We can do that, make a parallelogram, put a mast on it. Is that a boat? Could that be a boat? Yes or no?
I'm thinking it's a boat.
Sailboat, regular boat, whatever. So another one we could do, it depends on the boat you want. So maybe we want a little curve in the back. Maybe we want it to go like that with a big stern, like this. Maybe we want a smokestack on it. There's another. You see the shapes I'm making here, Chris? There's a rectangle. Here's another rectangle. Here's a couple portholes, right? Is that a boat? Sure, it could be, right? That could be another one.
Squiggly lines underneath it to even make it.
Yeah, so you can do the boat. There we go. Something like that. Let's see. Let's do another one. We can do a.
Now, at the risk of overthinking this while you're drawing these, does each one of these boats represent something different in each person's mind? Like when you look at that sailboat, that could kind of represent a different sort of metaphor than the steamboat in the water.
Yeah. I mean, it just depends on what you need and what you're looking for. But this is where creativity and design, you just think boat and then just start drawing shapes and start drawing ideas. And when I talk about shapes, you just start with a shape. So if we just do a parallelogram, then what does your boat look like? Is it a tugboat? Is it a steamship? Is it a motorboat? Is it a sailboat? So if we want to make our sailboat a little bit, let's give it a mast like that. Let's give it a flag. Maybe a little sail off the back and a big sail off the front. and we'll use this one. And then we're going to put a curve line right here and a curve line right there. Maybe a couple, maybe a little port, couple little portholes. There, how about that?
Woo!
Work with that one.
That's the fancy one that I can't afford. I like the little dinghy at the top. That's
the little dinghy. Okay. So there's, we're going to use that one. Let's use that one. Is that good enough? Is that helpful? All right. Now we got to stop sharing because I got to show you an app, and we're going to take a picture of that, and to that picture is going to go right into Illustrator automatically. All right. So let's close that.
Oops, he did it again, Chris.
Uh-oh. We'll find him. We have the technology to resurrect him.
So just in case you guys are wondering what he's going to do, so he's going to show us now. So once you go through the sketching process, right, and you actually draw with the pen and paper, now he's going to show you how we get this into something like Illustrator in a quick way, and now you can convert this into something digital.
All right, now, before I disconnect myself again, how do I?
You just have
I need to change my camera first. That's what it is. All right. Change my camera. All right, I'm back. Okay, there we go. That's what I got to do next.
There you are.
Okay. Let me get that set up. Screen share. Now what we're doing, we're using a tool called Adobe Capture. It's an app that you put on your phone. And we don't have, because of the streaming and the bandwidth, I'm going to do this really quickly. You should see, can you see my iPhone there? And I've got the camera looking at that. Okay, so I'm going to take a picture. Now, it's probably delayed, but I'm going to take a picture. It's going to come over, and then I'm going to refine it. I'm going to hit the eraser, get rid of the stuff I don't want. And I'm talking probably a lot faster than what's happening on screen. So we'll let it catch up here in a minute. And then, so you see me erasing there on screen. And then after I do that, I save that. And then it comes over, and then I want to refine it. So I'm going to hit smooth. I'm going to smooth it off. Then I'm going to crop it down a little bit because I'm narrating a heck of a lot faster than what you see on screen right now. But it'll catch up here in a second.
Yeah, it's actually going faster than it was when we were trying to
take it. Oh, yeah, now it's caught up now, yeah. All right, now I want to save it. So if I save, and then it'll ask me, where do I want to save it? And you see my Creative Cloud library right there. It says icons. So I want to save it to my icons. And I've got a bunch of different like categories that I can save things that you can create. And then we're going to hit save. So now it is automatically my cloud library. And now when I go to, let's see, we want to turn this off now. Don't close the video. we want to stop sharing is what we want to do. Stop mirroring. There we go. Now you see Illustrator. You should see Illustrator. Do you see Illustrator?
We see Illustrator with a blank screen.
Yeah. So now you can see my mouse. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So going back here, here are the tools we're going to use. We're going to use the two select tools up here in the upper left corner, your little tools library is really all we need. And the pen tool right here. Those are the three tools that we're going to use. And then we use layers, of course. You always use layers. And then here's my libraries. It's just a panel over here. So I click open my libraries. And I look for my icon library. And there's my boat. And we just simply drag the boat on the screen. And there's my boat. Ta-da! It's now a vector image.
Nice. Oh, look at that. You got all the dots and everything.
So it, now I could have refined that and cleaned up the dots and everything. But now I've got what I need. So if I need to, it's like, well, maybe I only want one of those, or maybe I don't want that.
Wow.
Clean it up a little bit, get rid of that dot there. This is obviously real rough, but I would use a better pen and a, you know, different paper if you're really looking for a production version.
Isn't there a smoothing feature, though? I mean, isn't there
something? Yeah, there is a smoothing feature. So
yeah,
you
the Illustrator could all of a sudden just snap those squiggly hand-drawn lines into straight lines?
Well, it's a little bit more involved because there's so many. And this is you asked this, but this is usually, wasn't a tool, but you go object, you select the whole thing. So you got the whole thing selected. Then you go to path and then simplify or remove anchor points. So if we try to simplify, there we go. Cleaned it up a little bit.
Oh yeah, definitely smoothed it out. That's awesome.
There we go. Smooth it out a little bit.
Cool because it still looks hand drawn, so it still has that stylistic effect to it. It just's not as not as squiggly. I like that.
So now if you want to go in now in Illustrator, we go in, I see this little extra where the ink pen didn't cover the white paper. You can just come in here and grab this and delete those little imperfections. And then, like I was saying, like, for instance, the come on, slow down. You're going too fast. Here we go. You can the pen tool. So this is where, like, this little point right here, I can grab that anchor and then just delete it. Oh, now if I grab this pen and then delete it like that, maybe I don't want this one. It just kind of cleans things up a little bit. We'll get rid of this pen, this down here. Oops, come on. Oh, I know what that is. It's not a...
not an anchor point.
It's not a, see, you can't really tell, but see how this one is not connected to anything. It's a loose. And here's the other one on this side. If I do view outline, you'll see that these two aren't connected. Hmm. It was an open gap right there. So to close that gap, you grab one, hold your shift key, select the other one, and then Command J. Well, I'm on a Mac, so Control J is join. So you join those two endpoints, and then you come back, grab your pen, and delete one. And then we can put it back the way it was. Something like that. And then go back to view. There we go. And what's nice about using Illustrator, one, it's a vector. So I can, if I don't like black, maybe I want a blue color. So let's change the color. So it's all vector. And you can change the shapes. And then when you export it, you can export it out as a PNG and then export as PNG. And we'll call it boat, I guess. And then you see the transparency right here. So you can save it out as a JPEG where it'll be all white, or you can save it as a transparent shape. And then you can increase the DPI. So if you want a really high resolution PNG file, you can change it here in Illustrator. And that's it. That's the only tools you need, and you're done. I mean, now that's hand drawn. Any questions so far up to this? Because I want to show you how you can build a few in Illustrator without.
I wonder if we should just define for folks vector, what that means, in case they're not into this world themselves.
Sure. Vector is just a bunch of points, because we, like Brent pointed out, the anchor points. So what it does is some math. So what happens is all of these anchors are vector points, where you can change the shape, look and feel of, you can change the shape any way you want. So let's say the wind's blowing, we got a little updraft going, whatever, like that. But because vector, it's about math, it's about calculating, and I don't know all the detail algorithm behind the math behind it, but between each anchor point, the math is. So anytime you change the size of a vector, it's all relative to those anchors. So the math changes to keep everything crisp and clean. So even if I zoom in now at that same one, you're still going to see you're not going to see any distortion at all.
Yeah.
At the risk of looking out on this stuff too much, is there any sort of standard size for icons or bit rates or all that kind of stuff?
Well, depending on what you're using them for, 16 by 16, 32 by 32 is generally the standard icon sizes. So like it depends on how you're using it for web. Like if you're using them for websites and mobile apps, then 16 by 16, 32 by 32 is your typical square shape. If you're doing a favicon for a website, like, the little icons that are up on your browser windows, those little icons up there, like your calendar icon, your mail icon, different things, those are 8x8. But they're still, it's an ICO. Actually, there's an icon format called ICO.ICO for those types of things. And then you can save your icon as an ICO and then put this boat as an ICO and then put it up on your website, and it'll show up like where all your other little icons show up on your browser. Like your Twitter bird and Facebook icons and things like that.
So in order for the different icon software and apps that use it, in order for them to find it, it needs to be in that .ICO format, or else you don't recognize it. It'll just show up like an image or anything else.
Right. All right. Let's do another. How much time we got? We got time for another one.
Yeah.
Or we have anybody out? We got another.
We have a couple of questions. Wendy's asking about advice for using this to create emotes for chat environments or chat bots. So I don't know if you've got any familiarity in that realm.
Yeah, so like an emoticon.
Oh yeah, like the happy faces and the thumbs up or
whatever. Yeah, it's relatively the same process. It's how you save it out and how you use it in the format. I think emoticons they might be the ICO. I'd have to go look at that. I think it's the ICO format, ICO dot file extension. That's a great question, but the process of creating one is the same. So we can create one right now. I can show you an example of one, maybe. Let's see. Do we want to do an ICO? I mean, an emoticon or another kind of icon?
Let's ask the team.
Let's ask them.
Let's ask the gang.
Let's do another icon. This time we're going to do it grid on a grid. We're not going to hand draw. We're going to do it right in Illustrator. And get set up here. There we go. Okay. One of the things in Illustrator too, what I've done is I've gone to the view tab and I've shown the grid, so I can hide the grid or show it. And then in your properties, you can set the space in the grid. And this is my grid, how I've got it set up. And then also I like snap to grid. So we're going to turn that on, snap to grid. And what I mean by snap to grid, if I just grab the rectangle shape, notice that it snaps to each square. It's just snapping. So I can keep things nice and like that's 72 by 72 pixels. So as I was mentioning before, if I need one that's 32 by 32, there's 36 by 36. I got this set up differently for something, for a different project. So he's like, oh my gosh, that's small. Right. Because, but if you look up here, my tab, I've got 150%. So if I go to 100%, that's what 36 by 36 looks like. But the great thing about Illustrator and working in vector is I don't care how small it's going to end up being. I can come in here and work at a very large scale and get very detailed. And it's still vector because it's mapping those points. So it doesn't matter. It's not going to change its quality, whether it's this size or whether it's, you know, screen size. So for the sake of our thing, we're going to do a, let's try some kind of an emoticon. Let's go with that. There's a face. What color are we going to do? Orange. We're going to do orange for nugget head.
Do you have a special orange that you used for nugget head, your own custom orange?
Nope. It's a web safe orange. Everything is web safe.
I'm just going.
All the colors are web safe. Okay. So now we're going to grab one of these shapes. Do it like that. Let's change that to black. And we'll put that in here. Make a duplicate of that one. Put it over here. And we've got a little bit of thing going on there. Well, we need a smiley face, I guess, is a good one. How do you make a smiley face? How do you get a nice, exact smile curve matches the radius of this? I'm glad you asked. Let me show you. First thing we need is this shape. So I'm going to make a duplicate of that shape. All right. And then I'm going to use what's called path, offset the path. And this is probably one of the coolest little tools in Illustrator. I'm going to offset the path by negative 10. And then I'm going to preview it before I say okay. So this gives me the shape that I see, the width of that circle. That's a little thinner than I want. So I'm going to go a little bigger. Let's go 20. See what that looks like. I kind of like that. That might be too big. Let's go half. Let's split the difference. Go 15. There, that's good. 15. Now, what happened there is
line on the screen share, but I get the idea.
It's hard to see what?
Well, just the inside line, but now that you've selected.
Oh, you know what? Probably because it's red. Yeah. Let's change the color. Come on.
Yeah, the screen share is a little lower res.
Does blue help?
Yeah, that's a little bit easier to see. Yep.
Let's go medium blue. There we go. But what happened, you say, what it is you've got now two shapes. Because what you did is you outlined the stroke, or you offset it, and now you made a complete exact shape, but 15 pixels smaller in diameter. And I need that because I want that to sit right here, just inside. So I make that one, get rid of the big one. And I'm going to do it again. Path, offset path, same width, 15. But this time, I'm going to select both of this, the shape on top and the shape below it. So I've got both. And now I'm going to use a tool called the Pathfinder. And in PowerPoint, you've got these four. That's Unite and Minus Front and Intersect. And you can get these in PowerPoint too. And what I want to do is Minus Front, meaning I want to cut this middle piece out of the one behind it. So now I just have a ring shape.
Ah, cool.
Okay. Now we're almost there. Now what I want to do is cut this in half. So I need another shape. So I'm going to grab a rectangle this time. And I'm just going to go about where I want that smile to be. Let me change the color of the shape here. It doesn't matter what color it is. So you see this. This shape down here is what I want to end up with.
Yeah.
So I can play around with how much of that smile I want. Right there's about About there, maybe. And then what we're going to do is we're going to do the same thing again. We're going to hold the shift key, select the other underlying shape, and do the same thing, minus front, which means we're going to use the front shape on top, the black square rectangle, and we're going to minus that off and cut it. And now we've got that. Now we can change this color to the same black, and now move this over here. Not quite exactly the, there we go. Almost, I guess. There we go. And then we get there, you can fine tune this, you know, all day long, but if we go, this is another cool feature of Illustrator. You see these little round, you select the, let me back up here. I'm getting ahead of myself. We've got the selection tool, right? Direct select. We've got select and direct select. Select selects the whole thing as a box, like a bounding box. Direct select, I'm just direct selecting where all the points are at. And when I do direct select, you see these little curvy, little arc mouse pointer shows up? Mm-hmm. I can grab one of these and it'll make a curve, but notice on both sides, it'll make a curve on both sides. So I can curve down those edges. And voila.
Oh, cool.
Ah, now you're talking.
There you go. Now you got a new emoticon. Ta-da! There we go.
Very cool.
All right.
Mark had a question, one more question that he threw in, which was asking, do you ever animate your icons?
Oh, yeah. I'm glad you asked. So...
We don't have to do that right now, but we are running out of time.
No, I've already got it. I already have it set up because I anticipated that question. So here's a project I did. This is probably one of the funner projects I've done in a while. It's about termites. And it was training inspectors, termite inspectors, on identifying different termites. In this part of the country, we have what's called subterranean termites. Anyway, so these are the family. This is the family: the queen, king, soldier, worker, and then the swarmer. And the swarmers are, you don't want to get messed up with those swarmers. So these are all vector shapes. So you see each one of these pieces are vectors, right? They're just little, like here's an oval pill shape, and here's a little S shape, and they're just copied and positioned to create a termite.
Oh, that looks like some shapes from the visual alphabet.
It does, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Now we take that one and we come over here, and here's our same little worker termite. But notice all the layers that I've got here. If I turn these layers on, it's a different walk. So it's a walk. Now, talking about animating a six-legged walk cycle, that was a little challenging. So there's one position, there's another position, there's another position. So you change the legs. The body stays the same, but you change the legs. You got eight, that's a walk cycle, eight different steps.
And then you just loop it.
And then you loop it. And then you take all of those into Photoshop and you add all of your eight layers over here on Photoshop. And then you use the timeline in Photoshop and you create a walk cycle, an animated icon. And then because this is an anim, then you export this as an animated GIF. And then that's what the animated GIF looks like. And then because that's an image file, you can take this into PowerPoint and Articulate Storyline into Lectorio. You can take it into your e-learning development tools. And because it's an image file, it'll animate because it's a GIF. So it's an animated GIF. And then you put a motion path on the animated GIF. And then you can have little termites walking and crossing across the screen while people are taking their e-learning course. And you just kind of randomly put termites running all over the computer screen as they're trying to take their e-learning.
Awesome. Well, we like to wrap up before the top of the hour, so I think we could probably call this good, eh, Chris?
Yeah, this has been absolutely fabulous, though. Very cool to see. Let's bring ourselves back. Well, I guess maybe I have to bring Brent back and me. There we go. Who's in charge of this place anyway? Oh, no, that's unfocused screen. Unfocused screen. Sorry, Brent, I'm leaving us in the dark here. See, their icons were confusing me.
What do you mean?
Next thing we'll do is we'll get better icons in Crowdcast so we're not all confused and pushing the wrong buttons. So.
It's a big subject. I know we only had a little bit of time, but if we want to do something a little simpler next time, perhaps we do something in PowerPoint where we can do a real quick collection, like four icons that go into a series in a set. If you're creating a set of icons for a project, like, you know, your typical ones like search and resources and tools and, you know, things like that you would typically use in e-learning. And then we can go into just going back to the visual library, just using basic shapes, create, combine, fix them up, export them out, and you're done. Half hour, hour's work.
And you're gonna have it sounds set. Like we just defined part three of Drink'n'Draw with Kevin Thorn.
Episode three. All right.
Very cool. Kevin, as always, thank you so much. And the folks in the chat, lots of enthusiasm and always some really great questions too.
Thanks, everybody.
I think I'm seeing lots of thumbs up for the PowerPoint idea, because that's a tool that, you know, everybody's got just lying around too without even having to get into another more sophisticated set of tools. So I think that's definitely got a thumbs up from the folks there. Cool.
Well, all of the tools that I used in Illustrator, they're arguably the same set in PowerPoint. They're just different. So we can show that next time and do a compare and contrast.
Yeah. There's a question about the visual alphabet. I'm just going to grab one link quick. I had actually keyed something up. I'm not sure if it's the link or not, but just as a parting. But
just search Dave Gray.
Dave Gray. Okay.
Dave Gray. He came up with it back in the 90s.
Pile up a whole bunch of things for you. There for the visual alphabet, just if you want to revisit that concept in that world. So awesome. Hey, I think it's time to dance out of here.
I believe I hear something.
I hear the siren call of the trumpet. Bye guys.
We dropped in the nuggetheads.net earlier, but go ahead and drop it in again so everybody knows where to find you in case they want to learn more, or if you want to share that boat with everybody, that would be awesome. Everybody have a great day. We'll see you next week with Shannon Tipton.
Bye, gang. See you next time.